Hey everybody, before we get started in the Book of Ruth, let me just ask you to hit the subscribe button if you haven't already, and that'll allow you to be notified anytime a new video comes out. And if you like the content that you're seeing, go ahead and hit the like button. So before we get started in chapter 2, let's go ahead and have a quick overview of what happened in chapter 1. So in chapter 1, what we saw at the start of the chapter was there was a famine in the land of Bethlehem. And as a result, a man named Elimelech and his wife Naomi, as well as their family, left the land of Bethlehem for the pagan land of Moab. What was supposed to be just a short time ended up being 10 years. So after 10 years in the land of Moab, and after Elimelech and his two sons had died, it was now Naomi who was heading back to Bethlehem, and her two daughters-in-law, Orpah and Ruth, were wanting to go with her. After some pleading, Orpah decided to go back to the land of Moab, but Ruth wanted to go back with her mother-in-law, and she said, "Wherever you go, I will go, and your God will be my God." So she was wanting to stick with Naomi through thick and through thin. And so that's a quick summary getting into chapter 2. So chapter 2, if you remember, we said the title for chapter 1 would be Ruth in Moab. If we could give kind of a quick title for chapter 2, it would be Ruth in the Field of Boaz. And we'll be introduced to Boaz in the first verse of chapter 2. So it says this: "Now Naomi had a relative on her husband's side. He was a prominent man of noble character from Elimelech's family. His name was Boaz." So Boaz is an interesting character, as we'll see more as we go along. But one of the reasons he's interesting, besides his own personal life, is the fact that his mom is Rahab, and his wife would turn out to be Ruth. And both of these women are included in the genealogy of Jesus later on. So he has a mom and a wife who are both very godly women. And as a result of his mother being such a godly woman, as recorded in the scriptures, if you remember the story of Rahab the harlot, who helped the Israelites as they were going to scout out the land of Jericho, she helped protect them, and God rewarded her with a family and with blessings along the way. So keep in mind that the fact that Ruth is a foreigner from a pagan land will kind of underscore the rest of the book. Now, the fact that she is not native born, she is not from a Christian heritage or a believer in Yahweh heritage, will underscore a lot of what is about to go down. So with this, we see that the timing is critical of when they happen upon these harvest fields. It is not a coincidence of the fields that they end up in at the timing that they do. We'll see throughout that God's hand, although not explicitly stated, is clearly seen throughout this book. So verse 2 says this. It says, "Ruth the Moabitess asked Naomi, 'Will you let me go into the fields and gather fallen grain behind someone with whom I find favor?' Naomi answered her, 'Go ahead, my daughter.'" So in this time, the reason why she's asking this, when she says, "Will you let me go into the fields and gather fallen grain behind someone with whom I find favor?" Gathering fallen grain, this was not just some random question that she was asking. There was a purpose behind it. Now, this was what was referred to as gleaning, and gleaning was something that God put in place to provide for the poor and the destitute in this time period. So God was putting something in place to protect and to help those that were less fortunate, who for one reason or another were not able to provide for themselves as easily. God had this kind of safety plan that he put in. So it says this in the book of Leviticus. It says, "When you reap the harvest of your land, you are not to reap to the very edge of your field or gather the gleanings of your harvest." And then 23:22 of Leviticus, it says, "When you reap the harvest of your land, you are not to reap all the way to the edge of your field or gather the gleanings of your harvest. Leave them for the poor and the resident alien. I am the Lord your God." Deuteronomy 24:19 says, "When you reap the harvest in your field and you forget a sheaf in the field, do not go back to get it. It is to be left for the resident alien, the fatherless and the widow, so that the Lord your God may bless you in all the work of your hands." So what was happening was there was a few things that they were to do for the people that maybe owned the land and were harvesting it. God had put some things in place for them that he wanted them to do. So one of the things was he did not want them to go over every square inch of the fields. He wanted them to leave the corners for the poor. So they would be still standing when they were done harvesting. The corners would be still standing for the poor to come and gather later on. But something else that he said was, in the course of them gathering the wheat and whatever they're harvesting, if some things fall on the ground, to not go back and pick that up, but to leave that there for the poor to later come and gather that. And this is the position that Ruth is in. She is one of the people who don't have much money, hardly any probably at this point, and she is now going to go into the field of Boaz, and she's going to try and glean and get whatever she can to provide for her and Naomi. So verse 3 of chapter 2 says, "So Ruth left and entered the field to gather grain behind the harvesters. She happened to be in the portion of the field belonging to Boaz, who was from Elimelech's family." So Ruth, because she was younger and had more energy, she was going into the fields to try and glean and get whatever she could. So this is great because it is a reminder for everybody that God, with this call in the Mosaic system, that he was telling the owners of the land that you are to have a generous heart, to seek after those that are less fortunate, to do things that can help them in their financial need. But it also gives a responsibility to the poor and the destitute. He doesn't just say, get in line and they'll just give it to you, or that you're just going to get a handout. He had an active and working role the poor person did in getting what they were needing. So God had provided this for them, that the owner of the land was to be generous, but the destitute was to work. They weren't just supposed to get in line and take a handout, but they were supposed to get to work in the fields. So Ruth was in God's will, but this was not easy. Sometimes Christians today think if you're in God's will, life will be easy, and nothing could be further from the truth. Now, sometimes in God's will, you're at peace and things go great, but not always. And Ruth is in God's will right now. She is in the Middle East, and it's hot, and she is working. So God has provided for her, but she has a responsibility on her end to keep up. Now, at the end of verse 3, when it says, "She happened to be in the portion of the field belonging to Boaz," it leads us, rightfully so, to be thinking that this was, in her mind, this is kind of a random, she just picked a field. She didn't know it was Boaz. Boaz doesn't even come on the scene until a little bit later. She just shows up. She's trying to do the right thing, and God supernaturally, he guides her to this field. She might not have known it at the time. Only looking back did she see his hand in this situation. And sometimes that's how it is for us. We might not always know with absolute certainty on certain decisions that we're making. But if we are trying our best to walk in the will of God according to his word, God has a way of guiding us where he wants us. And that oftentimes is the case, and that was the case for Ruth. So now picking up in verse 4, it says, "Later, when Boaz arrived from Bethlehem, he said to the harvesters, 'The Lord be with you.' 'The Lord bless you,' they replied. Boaz asked his servant, who was in charge of the harvesters, 'Whose young woman is this?' The servant answered, 'She is the young Moabite woman who returned with Naomi from the territory of Moab. She asked, "Will you let me gather fallen grain among the bundles behind the harvesters?" She came and has been on her feet since early morning, except that she rested a little in the shelter.' Then Boaz said to Ruth, 'Listen, my daughter, don't go and gather grain in another field, and don't leave this one, but stay here close to my female servants. See which field they are harvesting and follow them. Haven't I ordered the young men not to touch you? When you are thirsty, go and drink from the jars the young men have filled.'" So we see several ways in which Boaz was being a kind and generous man in these few verses that we just read. And one of the ways is at the last verse that we just mentioned, where he's telling her that the water that his men had gathered, if she's thirsty, to just go and get a drink. When this is completely backwards to how it was in the Middle East in those days. So in those days, if you're a foreigner like she was, you would get the water for the natives. And this is the opposite. And oftentimes what would happen is if you were a woman, you would get the water for the men. And Boaz is saying these native men are getting the water, but you can have as much as you want. And so Boaz was showing great generosity and kindness toward her there. And that won't be the last time that we'll see Boaz show kindness and generosity toward her. So this time it was with water, another time it'll be with food, and then another time it will be with support and help. But we see that he is providing for her in many ways. So in verse 9, I'm going to reread this. It says, "See which field they are harvesting and follow them. Haven't I ordered the young men not to touch you? When you are thirsty, go and drink." So he has told them that you are not to touch Ruth. He is protecting her physically. He wants her to stay in his field so he can keep an eye on her, so his people can keep an eye on her. He is trying to protect her physically, but he's also trying to provide for her physically. He's trying to meet her physical needs and protect her from these things. So verse 10 says, "She fell face down, bowed to the ground, and said to him, 'Why have I found favor with you so that you notice me, although I am a foreigner?'" So what she was asking is, she was well aware of the fact that she was a foreigner, she was a woman, she was a widow. There was no reason for him to take such a concern for her. Now, even though it was the Mosaic law to provide for the poor, you didn't, many times they didn't do that. But even if you did it, that might, they might just settle for the minimum. Boaz went above and beyond what anybody would find to be necessary when he is telling his men, okay, I want you to watch over her, gather water for her, throw out some extra things so that she can be helped in whatever way that you can. And what is her response? She fell face down, bowed to the ground, and said to him, "Why have I found favor with you?" So she shows a heart of thankfulness by bowing down to him. Now, this wasn't in worship, but it was in respect and just very much thankfulness for what Boaz had done for her. So how much more should we be thankful? Should we bow down and worship God for what he has done for us? If Ruth was willing to bow down to thank him for the blessings that Boaz had done for her, we should be infinitely more thinking about bowing down and worshiping King Jesus for the blessings he has done for us. If you're a Christian, if you've asked for forgiveness of your sins and put your faith in Jesus Christ, you have, of all people, most to be thankful for. And we should not let a day go by without telling God, "Thank you for saving my soul," because that is a thing that we can never get too tired of mentioning. But whenever she asks, "Why have I found favor in your eyes?" That's a good question. I mean, it would not have been common for something like this to go down, where you have a foreign woman, widow from a pagan land, who is being absolutely provided for by this wealthy man of Israel. But a better question than that in this context, better than "Why has Ruth found favor in the eyes of Boaz?" is, "Why have we found favor in the eyes of God?" And it's because of his great love for us, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us, that he has made a way available for us to know him and to make him known, and that's through his son. So verse 11 says, "Boaz answered her, 'Everything you have done for your mother-in-law since your husband's death has been fully reported to me, how you left your father and mother and your native land, and how you came to the people, a people you didn't previously know.'" So all these things that Ruth was doing to help Naomi, to care for Naomi, she obviously was not doing that for recognition. She probably had no idea that Boaz had heard about what she was doing for Naomi, but she did it because she knew it was the right thing to do. For us, we might not always see God. In fact, you know, probably none of us physically in this life will see God. Now, in heaven, thank goodness we'll get to see him face to face, but the fact is he sees us. He sees everything that we're doing. He records in his book every single thing that we did for do for good or for bad. It tells us in 2 Corinthians 5:10, it says, "For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ so that each one may receive what he has done in the body, whether good or evil." So ultimately, we will be rewarded for the good that we have done, and we will be withheld from receiving rewards for the good that we failed to do and the bad that we do. And Ruth, her life was laid before Boaz, and he was very thankful to see how she was living a godly life. For us, if we were to think about the fact that our life will be shown, you know, before God, and it's being seen day by day, God is seeing everything that we're doing, everything that we're thinking. He's keeping careful attention to our lives. Would that change the way that we live or think or do things, speak, the shows that we watch, if we were more aware of the fact that God is keeping careful attention to us, and ultimately one day we will receive rewards in heaven based upon the faithfulness we were working out for King Jesus in this life? So Boaz was a good man. That's what it tells us in chapter 2, verse 1. It says that he was a prominent man of noble character. So he was a prominent man. He was of noble character. In chapter 2, verse 2, Ruth expressed the wish to Naomi that she might glean behind someone in whose eyes she might find favor. This is one of those things where it might not have been specifically a prayer, but it was treated as such, and God answered this longing of the heart of Ruth, that she did end up in a field in the eyes of this man who found favor upon her. So verse 12 says, May the Lord reward you for what you have done, and may you receive a full reward from the Lord God of Israel, under whose wings you have come for refuge. My Lord, she said, I have found favor with you, for you have comforted and encouraged your servant, although I am not like one of your female servants. So it seems like Ruth is very well aware of the fact that she is not like his other servants. She is very self-conscious of the fact that she is from a pagan land, that she is a Gentile woman, that she is from severe poverty. And so she is making it abundantly clear that she is not like the other servants that Boaz might have, which makes her all the more appreciative of the fact that he is taking her under his wing. So verse 14 says, at mealtime, Boaz told her, come over here and have some bread and dip it in the vinegar sauce. So she sat beside the harvesters and he offered her roasted grain. She ate and was satisfied and had some left over. So he had already earlier provided extra water for her. Now he's giving her food to eat. He will be continually looking after Ruth in different ways throughout this book. And this goes to show his kindness toward her. Now, part of it is he has a special place in his heart for her, it seems, but also the fact that he is such an upright man leads you to believe that he would go out of his way to help anybody given this situation. Verse 15 then goes on to say, when she got up to gather grain, Boaz ordered his young men, let her even gather grain among the bundles and don't humiliate her. Pull out some stalks from the bundles for her and leave them for her to gather. Don't rebuke her. So he's basically telling his men, as you're gathering up stalks of grain, go ahead and just take some and throw it on the ground so that she can later come and pick that up for her benefit. So he's wanting to give from his abundance and give it to her in her poverty. So whenever he says in verses 15 and 16, he says, don't humiliate her, don't rebuke her. Earlier he was talking about protecting her physically. Right here, it seems like he is making sure to let his men know to not shame her in any way, to not make any type of rude remarks about her poverty or about her pagan heritage, and to be kind and protective of her is what Boaz was looking for. Verse 17, so Ruth gathered grain in the field until evening. She beat out what she had gathered, and it was about 26 quarts of barley. She picked up the grain and went into the town, where her mother-in-law saw that she had gleaned. She brought out what she had left over from her meal and gave it to her. Her mother-in-law said to her, where did you gather barley today, and where did you work? May the Lord bless the man who noticed you. Ruth told her mother-in-law, whom she had worked with, and said, the name of the man I worked with today is Boaz. Then Naomi said to her daughter-in-law, may the Lord bless him, because he has not abandoned his kindness to the living or the dead. Naomi continued, the man is a close relative. He is one of our family redeemers. So we will look more in chapter 3 about what a family redeemer is going to entail, and sometimes it's called a kinsman redeemer. But ultimately, there was a system put in place to help protect and provide for these widows, and Boaz was this man at this point in time. So now verse 21, closing up, it says, Ruth the Moabitess said, he also told me, stay with my young men until they have finished all of my harvest. So Naomi said to her daughter-in-law Ruth, my daughter, it is good for you to work with his female servants so that nothing will happen to you in another field. Ruth stayed close to Boaz's female servants and gathered grain until the barley and wheat harvests were finished, and she lived with her mother-in-law. So we are starting to see the wheels turning in this story where they were in absolute poverty. They stumble upon this field. They have no idea who owns it. Ruth starts working, and as a result, Boaz is seeing Ruth, and she finds favor in his eyes. And for us, we need to keep in mind that she obviously did not know the end of the story like we do now. She was living it day by day. And for us, where we're at in the difficult times or the good times, we need to know that what might catch us off guard does not catch God off guard, that he knows the things that we're going to go through, that we've gone through, or that we will go through in 10 years from now. He knows it all. And the fact that he can still work it all together for good is what makes him absolutely amazing, that even the difficult, the bad things in our life, he is so in control and sovereign that he can use the evil that others have against us or the negative events in our life for our ultimate good. But we see that Ruth was told to stay in Boaz's land, And that's what we should be reminded of, is the fact that we should not wander from the Lord's provision, that God has promised to take care of us. And it's whenever we start to go into the fields of the world and we see the enticing benefits that the world seems to offer, that's when we really get in trouble. Whenever Elimelech and his family left the place of Bethlehem for the pagan land of Moab is when things really started to go south for them. And for us, whatever situation you're in, if we go away from the living God and go toward what seems the most beneficial financially or physically or whatever, if it goes against the word of God, we're only going to do ourselves damage. Whether it's short term or definitely long term, it will always have a negative impact on us. And if not in a physical way, always spiritually, when we're disobedient to God, it will hurt in the long run. So we see in chapter 2, and we will see more in chapter 3 and 4, that Boaz is a picture or a type of Jesus Christ. So both make a point to love and care and to provide for the needy among them. Boaz was born in Bethlehem. Jesus was born in Bethlehem. Boaz was a kinsman redeemer to Ruth. Jesus is a redeemer to all who would call upon his name. Boaz was a wealthy man, and Jesus has great riches spiritually. And then finally, Boaz and Jesus were both willing to provide and to care for those in need. Now, here's the difference between their redeeming. Whereas Boaz redeemed and helped out this foreign woman, which was amazing, Jesus died for the whole world so that all who would call upon his name would be saved. So in closing, I want to just mention a few things. It tells us in Proverbs 19:17, it says, "Whoever is kind to the poor lends to the Lord, and he will reward them for what they have done." It tells us in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 2, that sometimes we have entertained angels unawares, which means there have been times where you have helped somebody out and you might have actually been helping out an angel without realizing it. But more even than helping out an angel or even a human, as important as that is, it tells us in Matthew 25:40, "Whatever you did to the least of these brothers of mine, you did it to me." And that's Jesus talking. He says, whatever you did to the destitute, to the poor, to the oppressed, it's as if you're doing it for him. And in the same sense, he says, next verse, he says, "Whatever you did not do for the least of these, you did not do it for Jesus." And I'm thankful that Boaz gives us a great picture of, he had great wealth, but he was not trying to squander it on himself. He was looking for ways in which to help others with it. And whenever we have an opportunity to help those in need, we should be the first, as Christians, the very first people to look to meet that need. Now, that does not always mean to give the person what they want, but we should be prayerfully seeking ways in which we can help others. So as we go forward, I hope that in the coming days, you would look for ways in which we can be a helping hand to those that need it, knowing how much God has provided for us spiritually and emotionally and in every single way. And most importantly, he saved our souls. How much more should that cause us to want to help others in whatever way that we can? So I hope this was a blessing to you, and see you next time.